For 18 months, thousands of people put their energies into the Granada Community Challenge. The projects are now worth £7 million. The Challenge of a Lifetime, Wednesday at 7.
Join us now on Granada in a celebration of the life of Marti Caine.
It's bizarre to be here in an empty Birmingham Hippodrome with no audience, no orchestra, and strangest of all, no Marti. She was brilliant, the old bag, wasn't she? I always called her the old bag, and she always returned the compliment. Well, this is where we take new faces with Marti, centre stage where she belonged, and me up here in the ashtray. And if you remember new faces, you might well be thinking, well, what's she doing on this tribute? Well, although we traded insults in public, from the start we were great mates. Marti was very special to so many people. Even if you only met her through a TV screen, you could feel her warmth. Perhaps even more so after her illness was diagnosed, because then you had a chance to see the real Marti. So it's the warmth in her living, rather than the sadness in her passing, that we'll be remembering here tonight. And I'm certain that's the way she'd have wanted it, because however grave her situation, it was always Marti that was first to make light of it. I mean, most people know that when her doctor first told her she had lymphoma, she asked, "Does that mean I'm a lymphomaniac?" So let's start by going back to 1977, when the public first began to realise that here was a real star in the making.
Oh, such panache. Thank you. Yes. Oh, yes, round it. Do you know, I did my shopping in this today. I got mugged by two stray flamingos. Oh, dear, mind you, you've got to be fit, you know, for show business. I'm a big believer in that yoga myself, especially it's strawberry flavoured. I did an audition last week for Charlie's Angels. Yeah. Trouble is, I'm no angel and I've got no Charlie's, but do you know? I said to my friend, well, she's not really my friend. Lives on this side. Filthy. Oh. Never cleans up. There's that many cobwebs on her staircase, it looks as though it's been backcombed. Safest place to hide your money's under soap. And I went there Wednesday because, oh, bailiff called. Oh, very embarrassing. It really was. Mind you, she handled it well. You know, he knocked on the door and she said, yes. He said, I'm the bailiff. She said, oh, take a chair. He said, I come for a lot. And yeah, well, she's, you know, I went for my lunch, actually. We had this lovely soup, actually. It got little dice in it and little plastic footballers and tiddlywinks and everything. I said, what's this? She said, it's game soup. Right, she said, bit dim, yeah. Thinks a lump sum's a maternity grant. Thinks reproduction furniture's a double bed. Imagine she were a child bride. Not a blight. Oh, she might have been a child bride. Normally. She was a child bride, yeah. She was expecting it when she got married. And imagine she'd do anything. Try anything once, that girl, I'll give her that. Yes, he went in for potholing yesterday. Left an empty pan on gas. Well, it was all the excitement, you see, because 3 weeks previous, she'd found this stray dog. Nice little thing, you know. And she rang the RSPCA up and asked them what to feed it on, and they said, well, you know, just titbits. And yesterday, like, it died of paper poisoning. So... So I went across because the wheels on my settee, you know, they got a bit stiff, so I went to borrow some castor oil. Keeps them running for days. Handy tip, that, isn't it? I got it on one of them television do-it-yourself programmes. Yeah, they tell you what to do when you're not wasting your time watching television. Mind you, my Malcolm, he's a big do-it-yourself fiend. Oh, yes. If anything wants doing, he shouts, do-it-yourself. Ever so lazy. Ever so lazy. Can't stay awake for a second. In fact, he has trouble staying awake for a first, but...
You've just seen one of the funniest ladies on the screen. I remember when she auditioned for me in Sheffield, and I said, I'm going to use you on the show. She burst into tears. And I said, why are you crying? She said, because I'm so happy. And I said, don't do that on the show, or we'll leave it in. And she said, oh, it's that sort of show, is it? A great one-liner, and she was full of them, as she was on the night she won the New Faces final at the London Palladium.
Oh, no, do you know, it's been one... I'm ever so unlucky. Do you know, I'm so unlucky, girls, if they cut my hubby in half, I'd get the half that ate away. And can he eat? Oh, what with this potato famine? Have you had difficulty getting potatoes? It's the Irish, they've forgotten where they planted them. Oh, look at that. and kids, they're a terrible expense, kids. Do you know, I've got twin boys. One's 9 and one's 6. What a confinement that were. Well, and have they got a funny sense of humour, kids, because our Mark came in last... Tuesday, because rent man caught me in, that's right, and he came in, I'm out, and he said to me, he says, Mam, I says, what, love? He says, our Mark's spoilt. I said, go on. I said, he's never been spoilt. He says, he is now, a steamroller's just run over him. Have they got a funny sense of humour? Funny sense of... What I'd really like is that plastic surgery, you know, and have me nose off. Look at that for a nose. And they were giving out noses, I thought they said roses and asked for a big red one. Look at that. No, but America, that's the place for all this plastic surgery. Hey, look at that $6 million man. Oh, hey. Could do 30 bobs with myself. Look at that. Ooh, I can see it now. Bionic boobs and nuclear nips. Anyway, listen. Oh, look at time. Can never get this little ball in Mickey Mouse's ear. Oh, anyway, listen. No, I can't stop, because our dog's not very well and I've got to get up early tomorrow to bite postman, if I do it right. If there's a wrong way to do it, a wrong way to say it, nobody does it like me. If there's a wrong way to say it, a right way to screw it up, nobody does it like me. Oh, well, I try to be a lady, I'm no lady, I'm a fraud. And when I talk like I'm a lady, what I sound like is a fraud. If there's a wrong way, keep it cool. Right way to be a fool.
The red hair, of course, I remember, and the long legs that went on forever. And I always remember sitting in the canteen there on the day of her first show, and she'd be talking about ordinary things, about the family up in Sheffield. You know, she was a housewife, and we had found her in one of the clubs up there, and here she was now doing her first telly. And they talk about 3 minutes of time on a talent show. It's not enough, but, you know, within 30 seconds, you knew that Marti Caine had something special.
For Marti Caine, the panel awarded the following marks. For presentation, 184. For content, 172. And for star quality, 183. Making a total of 539.
500! So, ladies and gentlemen, third is Ofanchi. Second, Aldeen. And the act that goes to Las Vegas to represent New Faces is Marti Caine!
I worked with Marti in 1987. That was the first time I met her personally. I mean, I'd been in awe of her beauty and her talent before that. But I played her brother in the pantomime. She was Aladdin, I was Wishy-Washy. It was Marty's first ever panto.
Look, you knew this was going to happen. You better tell your story or I'm going to stick my finger up your nose.
Oh, I'm sorry, Wishy. I honestly am.
We just sort of struck up a great friendship from then. I mean, she was very caring. Her dressing room door was always open. She had so much confidence that... I'd only done a couple of tellies up until then, and I was very eager to please and wanted to go out there and do it all. And she just let me have my own way, which is... I can tell you a lot of stars that would never do that, would not dream of doing that. There's a certain hierarchy, a certain way you go about doing these shows. But Marti, I used to say, Marti, I've got this idea. I want to go on then, go and do it. And she would even come to me, which was lovely. You know, she'd say, what do you think of this? And I'd go, yeah, all right. I'll miss her courage and in those later years, you know, I think that was an inspiration to us all. And I think not only was she a great comedian, she was also a brilliant singer.
For tea at two, I would just be there waiting. He left so soon, he'd only just arrived. He hummed a tune, one that I found romantic, and it filled the room down at the restaurant. He teased Francois behind the bar, and he left his tips in the candy jar. He carried on just like a song, and I always wondered where he'd gone. He never, never knew how I would dream about him. My rendezvous down at the restaurant, amidst a gaze. One day he sat beside me, and I turned the page down at the restaurant. Do you have a
I'm here to see just how far you can go on a gallon of petrol in this special edition Citroen AX. Which gives me time to tell you about sunroof, sports seats, metallic paint, stereo radio cassette, and the free insurance. As for the fuel economy figures, I can't wait to find out.
The Citroen AX Elation, now at the very special price of £5,995.
Tina, it's me. I'm temping. Oh, it's some office. Just one guy. He's a consultant or something. I think he's just starting. Doesn't look like one guy. Looks like a whole company.
Your stuff is printing.
Did you do all of this morning?
Yeah.
You really do a lot. These are great.
Thank you.
Warden Associates, hang on 1 second.
Hello? I could put my whole team on it if you like. Absolutely. I could have that ready as well. I'll get people working on it right now.
Cheeseburger and chips with extra onion rings, a chocolate malted shake. No, a strawberry. No, we'll have both. I have both. 3 jam donuts, a peanut butter sandwich with golden syrup, some garlic bread, and extra chips. And for afters, I'll have him.
Is this what you meant by talent, Scout?
Oh, certainly.
Do you know he's young enough to be yours?
Don't you know? Toy boys don't need jump leads.
Do you know, some of the things she picks up, a vet wouldn't put down. I love your jacket.
Oh, thank you.
I remember it when it was a couch.
So nice to see you finally found a hat large enough for your head.
Do you know, this is all bluff. We get on really well. We've got such a lot in common.
Yes. Yes, it's true. We're great friends. We're both chocoholics.
And so am I, yes.
Thank you. Well, but for years, Marty, confess, you spent years of your life looking up to me.
This is true. This is true. You gave me something to always remember you by.
Oh.
A pain in the neck.
Well, from the knees down, she looked fantastic. From the knees up, I have to make her wobbly of the week.
Yeah, well, it takes one to know one. Right, now...
But I mean, that style of humour is 20 years old. I mean, we've moved on from there.
Right. Now, now, ladies and gentlemen, if you're very good, Nina will tell us how she gave the poison apple to Snow White. We'll move on.
The frock was hideous. I think the frock was hideous. But I think she had a wonderful voice and overcame that. But she needs to trim down a little, get a bit of advice on the clothes, and she'll be fantastic. Beautiful voice.
Thank you, Nina. Now, now, and no letting the tyres down on Nina's broomstick now. Now, we'll go straight up to Ben.
I'd rather see Benny from Crossroads up there. I really would. I'm sorry. I've had enough of comics like that. Can't cope.
Thank you, Nina, then. Not quite sure about Joe. Next time.
I mean, unlike your frocks, Marty, I don't think he needs much support.
Whereas some of us need the Glasgow suspension bridge.
And I think also he should watch himself when he gets on the really high notes, because when he's really pushing it, he sounds a bit like a goat on heat.
Well, if anybody knows, you should, Nina.
Thank you, Marty. I mean, I'm sorry, Marty, but I think you look like you've come rushing out of a Hong Kong bar and brought half the curtain with you.
Sweet. She's got the rest of it over her shoulder. Look at that. Tell me, what is that hideous creature you have about your person?
It's a spider, you fool.
No, I was talking to the spider. Go on then, Nina, carve this one up with your silver tongue.
I think she's absolutely wonderful, and I think it's true.
In 1986, I auditioned for New Faces on this very stage. What an experience that was. I'd never met Marti before, but she was wonderful to all the contestants, but especially me. I think it's because I'm from Yorkshire. Mind you, you'd never have guessed it, because I've lost my accent since I've gone chuffing posh. But you know, to appear for the first time in a beautiful theatre like this and in front of the television cameras is a very, very nerve-wracking experience. But Marti, even though she suffered terribly with nerves herself, did her best to relax us. She used to say, "You've got this far, and whether you win or lose in this show, you're all winners." She was a very special lady, and I'm going to miss her.
And how much of your act is prepared in advance, how much is actually going out there on a wing and a prayer and simply responding to the heat of the moment?
You hope for that, because ad libs are always better. You've got A, you've got the adrenaline going through you because you're always scared. B, you've got the microphone. And C, you've got experience. So if anybody shouts anything out, it's almost 99% certain that you can come up with something from the computer banks to slap them down. Once you've done that, you've got them, they're yours. Because you've only got about 15 seconds to get that audience.
And are you always worked up, scared? I mean,
always. Yeah. I'm always ill before I go on stage, always.
I'll never forget the help that Marti gave me on New Faces. She was just brilliant. It was my first television appearance and I was petrified. I didn't know what I was doing. I don't know what I'm doing now. I never have done and I don't suppose I ever will do. But we was in the corridor 5 minutes before the show went up and I was shaking like a leaf. And I said to her, "How do you cope with the nerves?" I said, "There's going to be 10 million people watching this show. And what happens if they all sit there and go, 'Oh, that bloke's rubbish'? What do you do? How do you cope with that?" So she said, "Forget about the 10 million people. It's not 10 million people. It's just a family sitting at home in their living room watching the telly with some nutty bloke on it. And all you've got to do is work to that family. It's just a mum and dad and a couple of kids, whatever. Just work to that family and forget about the 10 million and you'll be fine." And she started walking off and I said, "Where are you going?" And she said, "Well, I'm just going to be sick in the toilets." And that's the way she coped with it. But for me, Marti Caine, she was just a magic lady, she really was.
Mm-hmm. "You've got nothing to worry about, just relax. Relax, look into my eyes, relax."
"I'm looking at your arms."
"Ladies and gentlemen, you will note there is nothing up my sleeves."
"Apart
now,
from your arms."
"Apart from the arms, yes. Now, it says here, take arm A and place it in position C. Yes. And arm B and place it in position D. Yes.
Marti, you can't do that!"
"Well, I'm not very impressed."
"You would be if you were in here."
"Yes, well, maybe you're right. I'll put it up there. You see, I don't understand it, because it says in the book I can do that."
"Where?"
There, look, paragraph two. Oh. Just a second on the bottom. That's it. Maybe I'm being a bit previous here. Let me see, he says on page two. Ah, yes.
Got it.
Turn head to face upwards. Right. Right, now that's turn face.
No! You can't do that!
Oh, you're right. It says, do not turn head to face upwards. Just... Oh. That's right. Pretend you didn't see that.
That's a close one.
Yes. Now, take leg A, this leg. Give me this leg, that's right. And place in position.
Get my leg over.
C. Yes. First time this week. And on this side. This leg now, please. And place the... Oh, this is...
Whoa,
difficult.
No.
That's it.
Not for you,
now then,
me.
It's... No, there's something not quite right.
No.
That goes... That's it. And this goes... That's it. That reminds me, I've got a summer season in the Isle of Man. Now then, next. It says here, take foot, that's a footnote, and ah. Ah, yeah, well, we do have just a slight problem here.
A problem?
It's that second-hand bookshop I've got. Yeah,
give me the book.
But this was more expensive.
But give me the book.
You'll find this problem is that, well, it's just that, not that it's too serious.
Marty,
I mean, we could bluff our way.
Marty, the last page is missing.
Oh, yes, it is. The last page is missing.
I don't think we should do it.
You don't think it'll work?
No.
Oh, all right, then.
I'll show you a card trick instead.
Oh, all right, then. You're not going to pull me leg, are you?
There's a saying in show business that you can take the act out of the clubs, but you can't get the clubs out of the act. Not in Marti's case. She became the most stylish of singers, an accomplished dancer who majored in production work and covered all aspects of comedy, including situation comedy on television. And that's one hell of a package of talent. I got to know Marti as a panellist on New Faces, and I personally believe that she had a creed that she practiced, not consciously, but subliminally. And it's a lesson to other stars and other people that attain a position in life. And that is, she believed everybody's somebody. Everybody's somebody. Marti was certainly somebody, but above all, a very special lady.
While tearing off a game of golf, I may make a play for the caddy. But if I do, I don't follow through, 'cause my heart belongs to daddy. If I invite a boy some night to dine on my fine fin and hattie, I just adore him asking for more, but my heart belongs to daddy. That was a Cole Porter song. Oh. I think the fella I'm going out with at the moment is a Cole Porter fan. At least for the first 6 months of our relationship, he kept asking, what is this thing called love? You see, when Cole Porter was writing, things were still romantic. The sea was still blue and Freddie Starr wasn't. Going all the way with a guy meant staying on the tram till you got to the terminus. Scouting for Boys was a book by Lord Baden-Powell and not something that Britt Eklund does of an evening. Oh, she's some girl, that Britt Eklund, isn't she? You've got to hand it to her. And I believe a lot of people do.
The best thing on earth, it's... I tried to explain, you sort of... You met with a set of people whose spirits have been slightly tarnished by gas bills and their husband running off, or the death of a spouse or whatever, and problems with the kids. And they sort of like that, and all these problems are half on the mind. If you can distract them by whatever means, even if it's with, well, that's disgusting, that's terrible, at least you've distracted them, taken the mind off the problem. If you can make them laugh or cry for something other than what's bothering them, all the better. They forget what they're doing, and it shines the spirits up, and it sort of reflects back at you, and it's a self-perpetuating thing. It's wonderfully, wonderfully rewarding. It's worth more than any money, any amount of money on earth, the reward you get back. It really does make you feel physically high.
Before we start, I'd like to point out that I'm not as thin as I look. It's your horizontal hold that wants adjusting. So can you do it now, please? Because, well, people keep telling me I'm anorexic. Yeah, I'm not. No. In fact, I've only just found out what it means. For years, when people said I was anorexic, I thought they meant I couldn't spell. Now, I've never been on a diet in my life. I mean, I can eat anything.
And when you stop at as many motorway cafes as I do, you have to. But I do watch what I eat. Oh, I watch what... Well, if I don't, you see, it falls off the fork. Or if I'm eating peas off my knife. Yeah. Anyway, the secret of staying thin is to practice something called conscious combination. Yeah. Now, conscious combination is not an exotic item of thermal underwear. It's the ancient discipline of what you eat with what. You know, like eating carbohydrate with protein or soup with a fork, you know. And I do a lot of stretching. Yeah, that's the latest health kick, stretching. I'm into stretching in a big way. The results are amazing. You feel the benefits immediately. Well, as soon as the paralysis wears off. The other thing that stretching does is to attack cellulite. Now, cellulite is the most mysterious substance on Earth, next to Kentucky Fried Chicken. It is. No, it's very strange because cellulite is something that men don't seem to get. In fact, most men think cellulite is a plastic lamp. Well, I wish it was. I'll tell you, do you know, it's a nasty, yucky jelly sort of substance, and it clings to your thighs, your buttocks, your knees, your arms, your ankles, your shoulders. It gets everywhere. You know, a bit like Terry Wogan. And if you've got cellulite, and if you're over 35, you have, don't, in a moment of unbridled passion, strip off in the kitchen. Because under strip lights, you look like a bad panel beating job on a second-hand car. And if you're a man, never tell a woman she has cellulite. Well, not if you want to live. I know a guy who did this, and his wife went crazy. She ripped all her clothes off and flabbed him to death. Dreadful. Actually, the reason I know all this is that I'm writing a book for the ladies who can't manage all these Jane Fonda exercises. It's to tell you how to cheat with a roll of cling film and a streak of masochism. Next week, I'm going to tell you about the woman who knew it was time for a facelift the night she leaned over to give a recumbent lover a tender kiss and her cheeks arrived 4 seconds before her lips did.
Two of a kind, son and sister. I'm keeping my eyes on you. I bet you think I don't know nothing but singing the blues. Oh, but sister, have I got news for you? I've seen a lot of suns go and die. Ah, but trust me, no lowlights gonna mess me around. So let me tell you something, sister. Remember your name, no twister. Gonna steal your stuff away, my. Got a whole lot of time. Must be I've been up that lonesome road, seen a lot of suns going down. Ah, but trust me, no low lies gonna rot me around. So let me tell. Honey, this soul's feeling fine.
Have you got a headache or have you got a headaches?
If I get a headache, there's nothing better for me than Headex Extra.
Headex Extra. Fast, effective, easy to swallow.
John Smith's Extra Smooth Bitter slips down like a penguin through a trap door.
There's an old saying, a penny saved is a penny earned. The Yorkshire farmers who founded Asda knew that, so they decided that to give their customers the best value in the land, they should offer them permanently low prices. Good, honest value, always. This Christmas at Asda, we've over 200 beers from around the world, all at prices that have been constantly checked to make sure they stay low, permanently low. In fact, if you buy the same beer, crisps or snacks cheaper anywhere else, we'll give you your money back. That's a promise. That's Asda price.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again. 'Cause a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence. In restless dreams I walk alone, narrow streets of cobbled stone, neath the halo of a street lamp. I turn my collar to the cold and damp. When my eyes are stopped by the flash of a neon light that split the night and touched the sun. And in the naked light I saw 10,000 people, maybe more. People talking without speaking. People hearing without listening. People writing songs that voices will disturb the sound of silence. And the people bowed and prayed to the neon god they made. And the sign flashed out its warning in the words that it was for. The sign said the words of the prophets are written on the subway walls and tenement halls, whispered in the sound of silence.
I met Marti in the summer of 1975 at ATV in Elstree, where we went to do a review show called The Summer Show, which was sketches and songs, with people who'd won New Faces, me and Marti and Lenny Henry and about three other people. And I was really thrilled to do it because it was the first time I'd had a regular job, really, since I'd gone into show business. And I met her the first day and we were having a cup of tea, and she came up and said to me, "The money's rubbish, isn't it?" And it was 125 quid a week, which I thought was absolutely marvellous. But compared to what she earned in the clubs, you know, it was nothing. And I had a really good time working with her that summer. And that was the summer that she did the All Winners New Faces show at the Palladium with Lenny. And she did win that. And after that, she was whipped off to Las Vegas and she did had her own show and all that sort of thing, and just disappeared into being a big star. I used to see her occasionally. She would show me her books of clippings, and she was really popular with the press because she was a very, very straightforward person. She was very honest, and she never seemed to hold anything back. And she was a very dignified sort of person. And the last time I saw her once she was ill when she was in pantomime with my husband at Oxford. And I saw her about 4 years ago, and I was pregnant with my second child, and I took my daughter, who was about three then, to see her in Bath at the Theatre Royal in Snow White. And we went backstage, and she was playing the Wicked Queen. And she was obviously really tired, and she'd just done two shows or whatever. And she let my little girl try all these fancy headdresses on. My little girl was really gobsmacked with that, and that was the last time I saw her. But I remember she was very elegant. She was obsessed with clothes. She used to have these clothes that looked like little cobwebs on the hangers. They used to look wonderful on her. And she was a, you know, I thought she was a really good singer as well. But I think what people will mainly remember for is that she was really funny.
Blue. I want to show her how she wraps my heart in chains, 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 chains. But every time it rains, I get metal stains. She sings like Patti Smith, diluted with Dylan. She wears a set of clothes that grows penicillin. It's all in keeping with the ultimate thrill in being a punk. Oh, she's totally punk. I said she's up to her funk in punk.
Tonight, it's funny, we all forgot what a great stand-up comedian Marti Caine was. You know, we'd see her doing all these dancing and all this singing and all the presenting, but when you go back to it, Marti was a real, real funny comedian in the clubs in Sheffield. She was really good, and she could deliver jokes like Bernard Manning, she could sing with the emotion of Jimmy Webb. Incidentally, that was one of the songs she did at in the seaside with me in Great Yarmouth, was a Jimmy Webb song called What Does a Woman See in a Man? And she loved that. She could create emotion in people. She could with me. She could sing the most beautiful songs, then hit you with the filthiest joke, and you were laughing before you realised that maybe she shouldn't be quite as rude as that. And I look back now, knowing that the last summer season she did, you know, I was lucky enough to direct it, and she did have fun, and she enjoyed being on stage, and the people loved her, doing what she did best. Look at this.
I've all my family traits. My mum's eyes, my dad's chest. Budgie's legs. I'm not sure about the nose. I think it came from a catalogue. Eventually. And I've always been thin. See, I was breastfed by my father. Childhood was so confusing. Well, it was my first time. I led a sheltered life. I knew nothing about sex. My mother wouldn't talk about it at all. She was very puritanical. Until I was 23, I thought my father's name was Filthy Beast. When they asked where I came from, they gave me a phony address in Barnsley. I had no sex education, so I went through the old-fashioned process of not getting any. According to my mother, she kept her virginity until I was 23. She kept saying how important it was not to lose it. I mean, I didn't even know where I kept it. So, I mean, how do you know if you've lost it if you don't know where you've kept it? I mean, does it just drop off, you know? Land like a hubcap, clunk. And boyfriends were no help at all. Whatever they were looking for were in my vest. Eventually, I met a fella, nice man. He got thrown out of the serious crime squad for laughing. I'd say he had the intelligence of an amoeba, but that's unfair. Amoeba can divide without a calculator. So he got married. I was so relieved. It meant I didn't have to wear my best underwear all the time. And on our honeymoon, my husband confessed that he'd never actually had sex, but he had seen a video nasty. So he couldn't make a start without a chainsaw and a couple of alligators. Eventually, we bought a second-hand sex manual, but it had some pages missing, so we went straight from foreplay to postnatal depression. Mind you, I'm glad I've got boys. I am. If I had a girl, she'd be locked up until she were 56.
My mother used to say, she said, the thing is, with boys, you've only got to worry about one Willie in town. With a girl, you've got to worry about them all. And you see, the thing about boys is they never worry about fashion and things like that, do they? I mean, any coloured T-shirt will do as long as it's grey. Right. I mean, man grew up all right, which is a miracle, I mean, supposing. I mean, because of my cooking. Oh, I'm hopeless in the kitchen. I just can't follow instructions. I even burn cup of soup. Useless. I had a go at beans on toast once, but I couldn't figure out how to get the beans out of the toaster. It's not non-stick pans I need, it's non-stick eggs. Finally, my husband couldn't take any more and he ran off with an older man. So I started doing cabaret. Yeah. I went out late in the evenings wearing a glitzy frock and too much makeup. Wonder what they thought I did for a living. Bringing up boys makes you very insecure. It's funny, I don't know whether you ladies have noticed, but when your son starts courting, on the phone, the girlfriends always sound as though they've got huge boobs, don't they? You notice that? Perhaps it's me, perhaps it's my time of life, or as my mother used to say, the change. I mean, I've been having hot flushes ever since them cowboy builders installed a loo. I went to the doctors, I said to him, I want something for these moods and my headaches. My doctor gave me these tablets. I says, will they cure the symptoms of the change? He says, no, but they'll give you fits and I can cure them. I'm going to get this hormone replacement. Oh, have you heard about it? It's wonderful. Margaret Thatcher's on it. Yeah, she is. Believe it or not, before she started on her hormone replacement therapy, she was a woman. She was. And what's more, it gives you loads of energy, which is essential for outmanoeuvring store detectives. It is. Of course, there are side effects. For instance, you get a bum like a bad panel beating job. What's more, it's an astrophidic, an aphrodisiac. Makes you want it. It's wasted on me, it is. I mean, in the old days, I'd sneak into the bedroom with a copy of the Ann Summers brochure. Now it's a Daymark catalogue. Because these days, the only thing that drives me wild in bed is biscuit crumbs. Let me leave you with some advice from my mother. Do you know what a successful woman does with a bum first thing in the morning? No? She makes him sandwiches and sends him off to work.
That's the Marti we know and love. From the moment that her illness first became public, Marti received thousands of letters from fellow sufferers. All of these she acknowledged. Many she wrote long personal replies to, and a few became close friends. But it wasn't just those who shared her suffering that Marti generously gave her time to. She was the greatest agony aunt the world has never seen. Many of you watching tonight, entirely unconnected with the world of entertainment, will have had your lives touched by Marti and enriched by the experience. With Marti on your side, you could fight any battle. She'd hate me to be saying this. Only recently she said to me, the trouble with my illness is that now people seem to think I'm some kind of a bloody saint. I'm not. She rang me the day before she died to say goodbye. It was very hard, but now I feel privileged and grateful that she did. At the time, I didn't realise how close the end was, because typically she was completely unconcerned about her own situation and only anxious to know about mine. Was I happy? Was I going on holiday? But then that was always her way. Perhaps one of those closest to her, apart from her family, was Professor of Medical Oncology at St. Bartholomew's, Andrew Lister.
Thank you very much indeed for inviting me to join in this tribute to Marti Caine, or Mrs. Ives, as she was known to us at Bart's. You've already heard of her professional attributes from her peers. Let me tell you what she brought to us at Bart's, to patients and staff alike. She brought a contempt for illness and its intrusion into our lives, and a healthy disdain for pompous doctors. She brought glamour and humour to an environment traditionally devoid of both. And she brought strength and hope to others in trouble by her very public example and by time given privately to those who are frightened. And when things wouldn't go right, she showed us all a remarkable courage. I'm very sorry we couldn't have done more for Mrs. Ives. She did a very great deal for us, and we already miss her at Bart's.
It must have been cold there in my shadow to never have sunlight on your face. You were content to let me shine. You always walked a step behind. I was the one with all the glory, while you were the one with all the strength. Only a face without a name. I never once heard you complain. Did you ever know that you're my hero? And everything I would like to be. Well, I can fly higher than me. May have appeared to go unnoticed, but I had it all here in my heart. I want you to know I know the truth. I would be nothing without you. Did you ever know that you're my hero? And everything I would like to be. Well, I can fly higher than an eagle. You are the
ever try to visualize heaven, or if we played a little game and I asked you what you would like heaven to be like, whom you'd like to meet?
Yeah, I'd like to meet Gandhi, and I'd like to meet JC, and I think God himself is the only one who could answer all my questions.